come people like me. Come all you travelers, tired from the journey. Come wait a while, stay a while, welcome you'll be. Come all you questioners, looking for answers and searching for reasons and sense in it all. Come all you fallen and come all you broken, find strength for your body and food for your soul. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place with the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. The wonder of love and the power of grace. Who worry about houses and money, and all those who don't have a care in the world. From every station and orientation, the helpless, the hopeless, the young and the old. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place with the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. The wonder of and the power of grace. And dreamers and schemers, and come all you restless just searching for home. Movers and shakers and givers and takers, the happy, the sad, the lost and alone. Come self-sufficient with wearied ambition, and come those who feel at the end of the road. Haters, accusers, abusers, heard and ignored. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place with the King of all kindness, who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. Come to the feast, there is room at the table.
Let us worship God. O God, you created the world, shaping tall mountains and deep valleys, flat moors and calm lochs, creatures that fly high and swim deep, variety that astounds us, a complexity beyond our comprehension. Your creation amazes us always, and at times makes us laugh with joy. O God, you created each one of us and know us through and through. You know our names, the number of hairs on our heads, the words on our lips before we even speak them. Oh God, your understanding of each individual astounds us, its reach beyond our imagination. Your comprehensive recognition surprises us. At times it makes us laugh with astonishment. So gracious God, who allows us to laugh as we contemplate the world around us, and the precious life of every human being, let us not doubt that everything is possible for you as we gather to worship and offer our joyful praise. Amen. Our opening hymn, number 342, 342, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your good time you appeared to Abram by his tent and life was transformed. In your good time you appeared on earth as Jesus and life was transformed. In your good time, you brought our life into being, and it is now our opportunity to be disciples in the world today. The direction of our lives has brought us to this place at this time. And as we reflect on the long history of the people of God and the ministry of Jesus, we are aware that millennium after millennium, people have tried to follow you faithfully. We are painfully aware that we stray from the path Jesus invites us to follow. So where we have neglected you or neglected others, where we have prioritized our desires and pushed down the agenda of the needs of those close to us, where we have boasted not in you, but selfishly in our own individual achievements. Forgive us, we pray. Whether we seek forgiveness often or hardly ever, faithfully and repeatedly, God forgives. Know the depth of that forgiveness and be at peace. In your good time and through the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, breathe new life into us that our daily actions may tell the world that we are pilgrims of the one whom death could not hold down. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The hymn I have chosen is Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. The reason for choosing this one is it was a favourite of my mum's and we also had it at our wedding.
Thank you. The reading is from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us.
The reading is taken from Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to chapter 10. Verse 8. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be worthy of you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Let us think about what it is to be called into discipleship. Sometimes I think that we make it far more complicated and confusing than it really needs to be. Our discipleship begins when we meet Christ and we hear him say, "Follow me." It ends when at the end we meet Christ and we hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." We can ask ourselves what is required of us in between hearing the first call and being welcomed home. Well, really all that is required is faithfulness. Faithfulness to the task of being a disciple. That's all. Faithfulness. Think about how Jesus first called those disciples. In Matthew's Gospel, we read of Jesus calling Simon, Andrew, James, John, the fishermen, going about their business, fishing, mending their nets. And Jesus comes along, "Stop what you are doing, come and follow me." Did they have any idea what they were getting themselves into? Peter, Andrew, James, John had no crystal ball that day when Jesus called them. When the call came, they were going about their business as usual, casting nets, pulling them back in, sorting, salting the fish, taking them to market, maintaining their equipment. However it was that they became fishermen. They had not chosen an easy profession. These four men were not fishing for fun or recreation. They were not nestling in a drifting boat on a smooth pond. They didn't have their caps pulled down over their eyes with a pole resting in the crook of their arms. Their call did not occur on a lazy day with plenty of refreshment in the refrigerator. These men did hard work. Their muscles ached from throwing and hauling their nets. Their hands cut from sharp knives and fish spines. And of course, there was always the smell. Fishing was a stable and profitable occupation, but they were not rich, but they were not dirt poor either. They made a good living, but it certainly was not glamorous. Jesus called them from that life. They knew what they were leaving, both the pros and the cons. They did not know what Jesus was calling them towards. We have the advantage of knowing how these things turned out. We know the joys and the wonders in store for them. We know they will see and get experience things that they could not imagine on that first day. They saw miraculous healings. Would it be worth leaving everything behind in order to see a paralyzed man walk? To see a little girl raised from the dead? To hear those intriguing parables? What would we give up to hear Jesus say to us, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven"? What would that kind of spiritual insight be worth? How much of a pay cut would we endure in order to see the power, the intensity, the energy of the transfiguration as Peter, James and John saw it? Responding to Jesus' call opened up for these disciples, these ordinary men, a spiritual adventure they could never have found on their own. What decision would they have made if they had known everything? Would they have considered the miracles, the parables, the presence of Jesus worth the cost? Accepting Jesus' call put them at risk. Jesus has been arrested. Danger lurks behind the scene in every call. Would they have responded so readily if they had known about the Garden of Gethsemane or the crucifixion? Would James have followed if he had known that Herod would have him beheaded? The way that Matthew presents the call, not one of them hesitated for a second. In the Gospel of John, however, the first disciples take some time to respond to Jesus. John the Baptist announces boldly to them who Jesus is, and the would-be disciples check out Jesus' living quarters. They have a chance to think it over. Have a read at John chapter 1, 29 to 42. The way that Matthew presents the call, we aren't even sure that these men know Jesus. The emphasis in his gospel is on how much we don't know when we respond. Matthew seems to want us to know that we really are leaping into the dark when we respond. Some of us may like John's gospel a little better. We receive some assurance of who Jesus is, and we can take a little time to decide. The emphasis in John's gospel is important. We don't want to blindly follow some cult leader or charlatan. We need John's emphasis on getting something straight and taking some time. But Matthew is also right. No matter how much we study, how carefully we make our decision to follow Jesus, we don't know what lies ahead of us when we respond. Not only do the four men leave quickly when Jesus calls them, but they leave everything behind. Even though fishing was hard work, it was their livelihood. They'd invested time in learning the trade, acquiring fishing rights, buying boats and equipment, but they just leave it all behind and follow Jesus. Jesus calls the new disciples in the middle of an important activity. Simon and Andrew just cast their nets. Apparently they didn't even wait to pull their net back in one last time. Matthew says they responded immediately. They don't even cash in the day's profits. James and John are mending their nets as they hear the call. They're preparing for their next expedition. They're looking to the future. We don't know what went through their minds, but they let go of their nets. We don't know what the four disciples thought, but we know some things about what Matthew thought of Jesus' ministry. Jesus came to bring light to those who had sat in darkness. And part of that darkness was political oppression. Isaiah had talked about the darkness caused by the Assyrian domination of the new disciples' ancestors. Now it was the Romans doing the oppressing. And part of that darkness was a sense of hopelessness. And part of that darkness was illness. And part of that darkness was spiritual depression and anguish. Part of that darkness was those difficult days that each one of us has from time to time, and those difficult days that some of us have all of the time. Jesus came to bring light into that darkness. Jesus came to bring the kingdom of heaven close to us. And Jesus brought a sample of what it will be like to be in God's full presence, to experience true justice and fairness where everyone has enough to live in joy and peace and safety. In Jesus, God has reached into our world to bring hope. And for Matthew, being part of all of that was worth letting go of our fishing nets and leaving our old life behind. And Jesus continues to call disciples. We still don't know where it will take us, actually. We know that there will be times when it will be a challenge. We also know that there will be times when it will feel right, that we will feel close to God, that we will feel filled with the Spirit, that we will feel at one with the world and at one with the cusp of heaven. But most of the time, it will be a challenge. That's why we really do need to come together like this in worship. For as we come together as Christ's would-be disciples, we find in each other mutual support and understanding. Even though we are isolated and at a distance from one another, we share in this same one act of worship. We find in this time of gathering the presence of the living God coming to each one of us in the places where we are now. We gather through electronic means, but we gather also through the Spirit of God, which unites us and brings us close and in the presence of God who comes to us. We find in our worship the source and the reason to keep on believing. You might be surprised to hear me say that Christians do not come to worship because they believe. What do I mean by that? Well, we come to worship not because we believe, but we believe because the one in whose gift faith lies is regularly met in our act of worship. Not because the act of worship makes God present, but because God promises to be always present. I will be with you to the end of the age. It was a presence, not faith, which drew Moses to the burning bush. And what happened there was a revelation, not a seminar. It was a presence, not faith, which drew the disciples to Jesus. And what happened there was not an educational program. but his revelation to them of himself as the long-promised anointed one, the redeeming because reconciling Messiah, the Christ. And it is the presence of this same God which gathers us, which inspires us, which sends us out as Christ's disciples to learn the way to fullness of life and to grow in faith through the grace of God. To be God's people in the world is to tell others of the things we have known and felt and discovered. We are called to be Christ's disciples. He stands before us and asks us to put aside what we are doing and to come and follow him. And filled with his Spirit, we are challenged to hear the words of Christ being spoken to us. Go back into the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and of teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age. We are called apart. We are taken on the adventure of discipleship. We are required to tell that story and make more disciples. And all of it in the name of Christ, who stands with us always and forever. Amen. We have used quite a bit of Steph McLeod's material in these recorded services over the week, and here is another one of his evocative renditions of a familiar song, How Great Thou Art. Does use it to reflect upon the images that have come into our mind as we've reflected upon our discipleship and the call of those first disciples. Steph McLeod, How Great Thou Art.
God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and see the blue and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How
God, His Son, has buried, sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, He bled and died to take away. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou
Our next hymn is number 693, 693, Beauty for Brokenness.
Thank you.
so let us pray. In the long summer evening, when light lingers and sunsets have time to deepen from light pink to deep red, we offer you our thanks and our praise. We remember and hold before you people in your world where the fading of the light brings not only darkness, but sadness and discomfort. May they know your light. When we gather and share food and laughter with friends, relatives, those whom we love, and also when we are content to eat alone, we offer you our thanks and praise. But we remember today and hold before you those who will share meals tainted with sadness, those who through no choice of their own eat alone, those who are hungry and have little food. May they soon know joy and plenty. When we have been offered a hospitality which was generous or unexpected, we have been blessed and we offer you our thanks and praise. We remember and hold before you refugees and those who are strangers in a foreign land, those for whom exceptional warmth and hospitality would mean so much. May they know a rich welcome and ongoing support. When someone knows us a little but not well, remembers our name, we offer you thanks for their care and attentiveness. We remember and hold before you those who have been forced to change names, or those who forget their names. The overseas student in a culture that feel alienated. Those who have been trafficked. Those living with dementia. May they know liberation and freedom. And here is too, as we take time to remember and hold before you those for whom we are concerned. Family and friends for whom we want to pray. Those struggling with physical or mental health issues. Those for whom life is a challenge. Those for whom the dark days seem to outweigh the light days. We pray for the wider world, those caught up in all those things that we see on our news. Those who continue to work with the situation of COVID-19, the medical staff, the leaders of the nation, the leaders of the world in every place trying to deal with this common situation. For the victims of it, those who continue to be sick, those who mourn the loss of loved ones, those who have lost their lives to this dreadful pandemic. We pray for the world in its continuing needs in other areas, the constant challenge of responding appropriately to racism, the way that some parts of our society are rejected and pushed to the margins, the people who find themselves on the edge of society or beyond its boundaries, those who feel that they have no place, no worth, no merit. As we pray for them, may we also challenge the injustice that puts them in their place and work towards overcoming those situations in our society where people are overlooked, rejected, pushed down, challenged. Ever creating, ever loving, ever encouraging God, we offer you our deep thanks use our gifts, talents and skills in the world so that our lives may tell out your praise and aid those whom we have remembered before you today. Hear our prayers through Jesus Christ, our loving Saviour. Amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn, number 503, Love Divine or Love's Examine.
Thank you.
Peace be with you. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us and remain with us now and always. Amen.